once had a job as a newspaper reporter. They wouldn't let me drink beer on the job. They told me I had to drink water. But I'm a blues man. Like the man at the newspaper says, that old boy.
So, before we begin, or as we begin, let me just say that I realize that I'm a dinosaur. I began my first job in 1976. I was a newspaper reporter. I worked in newspapers as my main job, newspapers and magazines, for about 20 years. And these were newspapers that were published physically, exclusively physically, delivered to people's doorsteps, etc. Same with the magazines. They existed in no other form. They were magazines. And I still get newspapers delivered to my house, and I get magazines delivered in the mail. But I've mostly been thinking, you know, that eventually I and the other remaining dinosaurs will die, and that'll be the end of that for print model, for the print model of journalism. And then recently I had an occasion to wonder whether that were true. It started with an article in the Columbia Journalism Review that was titled How Print Got Cool Again, which I had not expected to see. So we're going to find out whether that's true, whether there's a future for print, whether print could possibly be cool. We're going to begin by talking to a very cool person. That would be Kelsey Russell, a media literacy influencer and co-host of First Stop News. Kelsey Russell makes, among other things, TikToks about the virtues of actual physical print news. Kelsey Russell, welcome to our show.
Thank you so much for having me on, Colin.
Maybe before we get you talking, we can hear you talking. We're going to play a little bit from one of your TikToks. This is from August of last year. Kat, this is A1.
My girl, Annalise said it right on the nail. The newspaper is drama. That's why I want Gen Z to read it. It's literally gossip, and you know we love the gossip. But the other reason is because our generation is extremely overstimulated, has no concept of emotional regulation, which is why everyone's like mentally ill, suicide is up. And I'm going to help you understand why investing in physical print media can help our generation honestly just become stronger, smarter, and really change the world in the ways we want to.
Now, this is either an unbelievably cutting-edge statement or an unbelievably old-fashioned statement or both, but maybe you can explain why somebody your age would be saying things like that.
Absolutely. I think it is. I think it's an old statement and cutting-edge. I think there's some value in old ways of thinking. Listen, I am 23 years old, and I kind of was in this news stump. I wasn't consuming any news. And the news that I was consuming was coming from a social media post during a scroll on Instagram, Twitter, TikTok, sometimes LinkedIn. And I made a commitment that I wanted to know more about what was going on in the world. And I realized that when I was interacting with news on social media, I would become overwhelmed with it because it wasn't just existing in this avenue of news. It was existing in this device where I was also seeing a post of somebody I was jealous of on a trip and my mom texting me, did you pay your bills? And an email coming through from a project that I'm working on. So I went back to print, which is what I originally read. I would read the newspaper in the morning when I was like 7 or 8 years old because I wanted to learn more, but just the news. I wanted to set time aside for me to read, just think about how it made me feel and then go about my day versus doing it all in this, you know, big scroll on social media, essentially.
Yeah, you know, you talked about the kind of distractions that come in with your mom texting you or whatever. There's also that whole question of, we did a whole episode, I guess it was last year, about rabbit holes. You know, once you start reading something, maybe you get interested in some kind of side issue related to it, you jump over to that. Then you have to look up something on Wikipedia to help you understand the thing that you just read, but that makes you think about something else. There, you know, a print version at least offers you the promise of completion. You get done with the article, and at least for the moment, you're done. Is that part of the appeal?
That is part of the appeal. I do think it pushes me to finish an article, but I think that rabbit hole that we go down on the internet, what we forget is that it exists in this vacuum of a positive algorithm, right? It's an algorithm that we feed into our phones and our computers, and the output is what we have shown our computer phone that we're interested in. When you read print, you're more so reading on that natural sense of curiosity. I might end up reading about the next flower that's going to be blooming in a month because the author has the same last name as my best friend. That's not going to happen, and that natural sense of curiosity isn't going to come about when I'm on my phone. So I do think it is about that completion, but it's also that what I am completing is coming from a natural sense of curiosity versus one that is kind of created by an algorithm that I fed.
Yeah, I think that's a great point. I mean, I'm way, way, way older than you, but I've kind of transitioned into getting an awful lot of my news in the digital space. And yeah, you start to look at stuff that you already know that you're interested in, as opposed to stuff that you don't know that you might be interested in. Whereas if I read, you know, the first section of the Sunday New York Times, I've already gone on some trips that I wasn't planning. And I think that is part of kind of being informed. That's sort of what you're talking about, right?
Yeah, exactly. And I love that you called it trips that I didn't think about taking. I never thought about how when I'm reading a newspaper, it is like I'm traveling across different sections. And I think there is, I mean, we're all humans, right? And we all like the things that we're naturally interested in. And I think that that's something the newspaper gives me. If I'm on the site of a newspaper or any media outlet, I'm not going to click on the different tabs of business, of living and arts. For some reason, I'm not. When it comes to reading my newspaper, you know, I might be having like a really bad day and I honestly do not want to consume the international news, but I might want to read the arts and leisure section about what's going on around my area or even in another area. So I also think that the newspaper gives you a chance to really think about what type of media, what type of information you want to consume that I don't feel like I have when I'm reading the news on my phone or laptop.
Yeah, and I think there's one more dimension to this, too, that is part of everything that you've been saying so far. But it's worth noting that, like, I'm a news junkie. I like news. I want to be informed. It's part of my job. It's part of my lifestyle. Sounds like it might be part of your lifestyle, too. But, you know, with our phones, I'm going to make this point later about push notifications and stuff. But there is that whole thing of you're never completely separated from the news. I love news, but I don't necessarily want a little thing vibrating in my pocket when I'm driving to tell me that, you know, that Donald Trump just fired James Comey or something. I'd like to wait until I'm actually ready to consume some news. And that's another virtue, I guess, of the kind of analog paper print version of newspapers. You can pick a time when you're plugged into the news.
Exactly, exactly. And I think it goes on to like Generation Alpha and Generation Z is that we are a really, really cool generation that has a lot of access to information, probably more readily available access than any other generation. And I think a lot of folks might be like, oh, well, that means you guys should know more. The other side of that coin is we're really overwhelmed with the amount of information out there. I mean, we are literally the generation that turned, not even our generation, almost everybody nowadays, first thing they do when they wake up is look at their phone. And the last thing they do before they go to bed is look at their phone, and all the moments in between are connected to our devices. So I think for a younger generation, it's really important that we start to really think about when, why, and where we are consuming information, because we are already overwhelmed because of what we are consuming. And that's when you actually can start to think critically and make better decisions of like, I do really care about this cause. How can I get involved versus thinking there's so much going on in the world? It's so dooming and there's not anything I can do. So I just think it's really needed for a generation that's quite overwhelmed with information, along with the expectation that we are supposed to do something with that massive influx of information.
So, Kelsey, one thing that you do for that overwhelmed generation in your TikToks, and I am now one of your 90,000 or so followers, you tell them where to get this stuff. Where would you get a physical newspaper? Where would you get a physical magazine? I mean, to me, being my age, it's kind of hilarious, but it's a real problem probably for Gen Alpha.
Oh, totally. I mean, think about it. Like my mom yesterday, I just graduated. And my mom, thank you so much. And my mom was asking me, you know, how do you do this thing on Instagram? And to me, I'm like, how do you not know how to do this? But I can only imagine how much screen time I spend on Instagram. I'd actually prefer not to know. But, you know, a younger generation, we don't know where to get newspapers. I mean, I have people who comment, Is it, this might be a silly question, but do you get this delivered to your door every day? Where can I go? And a lot of things in the world have changed and people don't know where to get those physical newspapers. So I think by seeing somebody like myself who is young, people feel comfortable asking that question that they might feel embarrassed to ask somebody who is decades or years older than them. So people don't know where to go. And they also, it's been a great way for people to fall back in love with their public libraries. Even their school libraries, a lot of schools get newspapers and they're not distributing them to their classrooms or to their students. So it is interesting that they don't know, but it's really good that they're asking.
So how are you doing with converts? How's it working out? What kind of feedback do you get from Zoomers and Gen Alpha people about this idea you have that there's some value for them in physical newspapers and magazines?
Totally. I have to say, the easiest generation to convert is actually millennials, because they are the generation that really lived through watching their news be on print and turn to digital. And so for a lot of them, it's this nostalgic thing of they're the easiest of, oh my goodness, I used to love doing this. I'm going to go get a magazine. Gen Alpha actually shouldn't even be on TikTok, so I shouldn't even be talking about them being a convert, but I'm sure they have it. But Gen Z, you know, they say it's refreshing and it's nice to spend the morning reading a newspaper and learning about something that they often thought was quite daunting. And they also, local newspapers, a lot of young people don't know about the community activism and action that's going on around them. So I think it has helped a lot of people feel empowered, feel calmer when getting the news, and realizing all of these weird-ish niches we have, whatever our obsession is in knowledge, there's a magazine, there's a print version for that. So I think people have also just felt that their voices are actually represented in print more than they think.
You know, one of the things that you do with physical articles, Kelsey, is highlight them, take notes on them, things like that, kind of engage with them. I mean, I think when we're on Instagram or TikTok or any other kind of digital social media, it's like watching an anthill. The ants are just swarming all over the place. It's not like watching one bird in the sky, but it feels like watching your TikToks that one of the things you do is actually have a kind of engagement with the physical article that you read.
Yes. And I got that all. I mean, I've been in school for a while now, but I used to tutor seventh graders, like fifth through eighth graders. And I use the same annotation skills that I use for them because, you know, it's scientifically proven that writing and actually using your hands and interacting with print, it's better for you to retain information. So I do all those notes to help people see, you know, this is actually how you retain information. The first step is reading it, but the second step is highlighting, is annotating, and telling your brain, hey, this is interesting to me. This stands out to me. So I also think it reminds people you are smart. You have the ability to annotate, to take notes, which is something that a lot of people haven't done in a long time. So that's why I do it. And I mean, TikTok, it's so many things about the algorithm. The more interesting things you can put into that small picture, the better the engagement is. So it's a little bit about helping people, but also knowing how to work that algorithm on TikTok.
So this is sort of just a sense of things kind of question, but do you feel like you're Johnny Appleseed and, you know, you're planting apple trees and they're going to start growing all over the place? Or do you feel like one lonely voice crying in the wilderness? I mean, does this feel like something where you might really, you know, be part of a movement to get back to some of this stuff?
Oh, wow. I love this question. I also haven't thought of Johnny Appleseed since elementary school. I have to say, you know, I do hope I am like a Johnny Appleseed, and I hope that the print media revival is just one seed that I'm planting. You know, I've always been on a mission to help people fall in love with learning. I've always loved learning. I come from a family of educators. I also come from a family of entrepreneurs. So I love thinking about innovative ways that we can get people loving learning. So I hope that this is just one seed that I'm planting. And I hope that it leads me down another path of what's a new way we can get people to engage. So my answer is yes. And I just hope that this is one apple tree, and I hope that the next one might be maybe a lemon tree or a mango tree.
That's a beautiful handling of that particular metaphor. And Kelsey Russell, one thing I can tell you is you are going places, young person. And five years from now, I'm not going to be able to convince anybody Kelsey Russell was on my show when she was 23. But Kelsey Russell is a media literacy influencer and co-host of First Stop News. Thank you for your time today.
Thank you for having me. And you are amazing, too.
Thanks very much. We'll take a break. We'll come back. We'll talk to somebody who's maybe not so optimistic about print.
Scene 6, the Schlimmer Market. A stinky place full of rotten fruit, dead bodies, and antiques.
Donkey for sale!
There's a small monkey!
Rotten fruit and biscuits here!
Rumors about Gutenberg spread like the plague.
Hey, beef fat trimmer, see you chopping some meat.
I just can't seem to chop off these feet. Four more steaks and I'll have finished the herd.
Well, then take a break and tell me what's the word.
What's the word? What's the word? Well, I shouldn't say this, but late last night, in the wine press shop, there was a light. I saw Gutenberg through the window pane. He was sweating, he was working, he was shouting his name. Now, I wouldn't bet money, but I think it's true.
Believe it or not, that's from Gutenberg the musical. There is such a thing. I've actually seen this musical. Unfortunately, we're not going to be talking about it. We're going to be talking about something else with Jeff Jarvis, author of The Gutenberg Parenthesis, The Age of Print and Its Lessons for the Age of the Internet. His new book, The Web We Weave, will be out this fall. He co-hosts the This Week in Google and AI Inside podcasts. I've been reading his work for decades and decades. I'm very excited to get to talk to him. Jeff Jarvis, welcome to our show.
I'm excited to be here, Colin. Thank you.
So let's go back to 1454, 1455 or so. There is, well, maybe we should step back before we do that. And just, you should maybe give us a précis, the central thesis of your book. What is a Gutenberg parenthesis?
That's coined by three academics at the University of Southern Denmark who argue that the age of print was an exception in history. That before print, we were primarily conversational. And now in what follows print in this age of the internet or AI or whatever it's going to become, we become conversational again. And that doesn't mean we forget what happened in the age of print, but it means we might be able to recapture part of what we were before it had such profound impact on us as a society.
So basically, we're saying that, you know, the view from 3,000 feet or 5,000 years, print is going to be a little bit of a blip, at least as the primary mode of kind of getting things in order in the world of information.
A profound blip, and a blip we won't forget. It still has an impact on us. I mean, the age of the scribes, you could argue, continued until the typewriter. So I think that the impact that print has had on us, the way it affects our mindset. Marshall McLuhan said that once print came along, the line, and this sentence is an example, became our organizing principle. We became linear. We expected things to have beginnings and ends and to be contained. That's our cognition of the world. And I think that will stay. But digital, the internet, AI are going to have an effect on that that we don't yet know.
Right. So McLuhan also said that every innovation in communication or media or whatever we want to call it is attended by large currents of anxiety. And that's certainly the case with movable type, right? There's quite a bit of excitement, quite a bit of interest in what it can accomplish. But, you know, I mean, famously, the Abbot of Sponheim, the infamous Johannes Trithemius, who's running a scriptorium full of monks who are scribbling away, hand copying all their manuscripts. He writes a piece called In Praise of Scribes and basically argues, Jeff, this is a very Jeff Jarvis thing. I'm sure you can do it better than I can. But he basically argues that this is a holy activity. It's connected to God and it connects its users, the scribes themselves and the people who consume this stuff, to God. And this is, it's not going to be so great. We might be headed towards dark times with this movable type stuff. And then irony of ironies, he publishes it because he wants a lot of people to read it. But there is, at that time anyway, a sense of, well, what's up here? And what's it going to do to us to have this whole new technology? Not that that's probably what they called it.
Yes, but he also loved books and he bought printed books and he just didn't want to lose the value that he believed was scribal culture. My favorite story from that period is that the first alleged call for censorship of print came in 1470, about 15 years after Gutenberg's Bible, by Niccolo Parotti, a bishop and translator who was much offended by a shoddy translation of Pliny. And he wrote to the Pope and said something must be done. Sound familiar? Mm-hmm. And argued that the Pope should appoint some reasonably learned person to approve everything that came off the press, obviously having no sense of the scale of what would follow. But as I thought about this, I thought it wasn't censorship he was asking for at all. He was anticipating the establishment of the institutions of editing and publishing, which would, all in all, assure quality and authority and artistry in print for half a millennium. Those institutions today, I think, are inadequate to the scale of speech today. And so I think we're awaiting the arrival or the invention of new institutions that help us find the good stuff and maintain quality in our culture.
So, you know, you and I are exactly the same age, and we both grew up in the world of print, and we had jobs in the world of newspapers and magazines. And for us, I mean, it's been interesting to behold this transition. But I think also for us and for our peers, it's hard. It's hard to maybe even accept the argument that you're making about this very, very important, deeply important blip, because we think of this as, at least an awful lot of people from our generation think of this as a better time. I one time was doing these lectures for people, you know, kind of retired people or whatever. It was called the President's College at the University of Hartford. And I said, imagine a big red switch on the wall, and if you threw it, digital culture would go away. And you would have everything you used to have, but none of the things that came with digital culture. And almost everybody raised their hand and said, oh, you know, we would throw the switch. Do we fetishize print and that kind of analog culture over digital to an extreme degree, to a wrong-headed degree?
I used to think so. My first book was called What Would Google Do? And in it, I argued that books should be updated and linkable and clickable and arguable and all kinds of things. And that we were loath to update the book because we were too much in love with it. In the Gutenberg parenthesis, I recant that. And I say that in the end, let the book be the book. The book is an established institution that is the thing we judge our culture against. I think that'll be the case for a very long time. However, I think that newspapers and magazines, I hate to say this to a fellow newspaper guy, are doomed in print. I wrote another book called Magazine for the Object Lessons series at Bloomsbury about magazines. And in researching that, I saw that magazines had their time in society. They were invented at first because there was an explosion of more content and there was a desire to find the good stuff for people. Harper's in 1850 started in its second paragraph saying, we're here to bring you the best of what's now being produced. And so I wonder, where is that Harper's of 1850 for today? Because books are still books and they're produced much as they were in the early modern period. But magazines and newspapers, I think, are going to disappear as we knew them. Meanwhile, much of the content online, podcasts and blogs and social media and TikTok and so on, are not published, are not edited. And we could ask maybe that they should be, but I don't think that's my call any more than Niccolo Parotti wanted censorship. What I want is a structure to find authority and find expertise and find quality and artistry, because it's out there. There's a lot more chaff out there, but that means there's a lot more wheat out there too. And I think we have to be open to it. And trying to turn off the internet, I think, would be a terrible, terrible mistake. Certainly, we wouldn't have survived the pandemic without it.
Absolutely not. So, yeah, I think one of the issues, though, in terms of the location of authority and responsibility becomes, without idealizing it too much, a little clearer in the world of print than it has been. Let me give you a specific example that's actually from the transition period that you're interested in. I'm sure you remember this story. It's like the most Jeff Jarvis story ever. There was a guy named John Siegenthaler who had been, I think, the publisher of the Tennessean and been involved in starting USA Today. He was a newspaper guy. And he found out that his Wikipedia entry, he was close to the Kennedy family, and he found out in 2005 that his Wikipedia entry had been, well, he didn't even know he had one, but it had all this wrong stuff about him, specifically that he might have had something to do with the assassination of Bobby Kennedy. He was one of Bobby Kennedy's pallbearers. And he just flipped out. He didn't know too much about Wikipedia. And so, but thinking like a newspaper guy, he thought, well, where are their offices? Who can I talk to? Who's in charge of all this? You know, how do I get a correction? He started thinking about it the way you would think about something that was maybe wrong in a newspaper. And, you know, he eventually did find Jimmy Wales, I guess. And he said, well, who's responsible? And Jimmy Wales sort of said, well, everybody, nobody. It doesn't work the way it used to work. And, you know, Jeff, I feel like there's a sense, maybe a misplaced sense that we had that, you know, printing presses, publishing things, there's a seriousness about it because you can be held accountable. You can even be sued. And that in this era of destabilization and decentralization, some of that goes away. It's less clear who's even responsible for what's up there on TikTok.
Colin, I think it's really important to go back to the beginning of Gutenberg. When print arrived, it was not trusted. Hmm. There was no sense of its provenance. Anybody could print this thing, just like today, anybody could make a Facebook post or a YouTube video. You didn't trust that. What you trusted was a system at the time, a social system called FAMA, F-A-M-A. Hmm. In Latin, it means it is said. And it was a social system of responsibility and reputation. And fama, good or bad, it's the root of words like fame and infamy. Good fama or bad fama attached to a piece of information, to the teller, to the subject, to the source. And that's how people figured out what to believe and what not to believe. They had to come up with systems for print over really about a century before they started to see print as something that was credible. And not necessarily more credible than what we would today call rumor. By the way, one of my favorite things of the story is that Fama was also a mythical beast in, among other things, the Aeneid, where it's a beast that is covered with feathers. Every feather has an open eye, ear, and mouth, and it watches over the city. Internet, thy name is Fama.
Yeah. Well, yeah, and so early newspapers are also, the early newspapers look more, I think, can look more like the internet and like blogs and stuff.
Yes.
Like that. I mean, a lot of times, you know, I'm sitting here in Connecticut, the Connecticut Current, you know, started in 1764 or something like that. A lot of it is like, oh, there's a boat at the docks right now and the captain just told us something, or somebody just got a letter from their relative in Pennsylvania and then they just print the letter in its entirety. I mean, it wasn't like you could fact check these kinds of things. So, I mean, early print was a lot like what people don't like about the internet, which is it was hard to verify what was true, even if someone wanted to.
In fact, there wasn't much effort to. The earliest newspapers were descendants of a VC, which were handwritten newsletters. And the early newspapers as well all said, we don't edit. We don't add any commentary. We're just telling you what others said. We just pass it along. And that was the case for a long time. The idea of a reporter and a journalist, interviews were a very controversial invention. They were seen as somewhat intrusive. So the idea of the journalist being out there to report is fairly recent in history. But it's also important to say that I have a book of all the newspapers in America in 1900, and it is very thick, and New York alone had dozens of daily newspapers. And so people had their own sense of their own community, of their own publications. It's only when television killed all these competitive newspapers and other technologies killed them that we get to this monopolistic sense that there's one great voice that Walter Cronkite says, and that's the way it was or is. But to most Americans, it wasn't. And so I celebrate the fact that today we hear the voices who for too long were not heard in mainstream mass media run by people who look like you and me, which is to say old white men. I celebrate this cacophony of democracy. It's hard to get used to. We need new systems and structures to help us get through it, but there's a lot to love there.
Yeah, I would say that, you know, the first 5 to 7 years of this century were very, very exciting that way. And there was a democratization of this stuff. I remember some of the early bloggers, they'd be covering the same stuff that I was covering. And they would say, you know what the difference between me and you is? And I'd say, what? And they would say, a paycheck. You get one, I don't. But other than that, you know, other than that, you don't have any. And it is true. It's not that you get your journalism license. You know, I mean, electricians have to prove they can do what they're supposed to be doing. We don't. We do it on reputation. And I think digital culture, one of the first things they did was say, well, you know, what if somebody else can do it better, but they don't have a job in a fancy building downtown?
Yeah, I think that's true across art as well. Look at music. There's tons more genres and tons more artists who are being heard. Not all of them are getting paid. I don't know what the business model is going to be. And I think it's going to get a lot more complicated with AI, because now Google at its I/O conference this week, you know, announced that they're going to put on more answers on the search page. And one hopes that they're going to attribute that and cite it and link to it from the source. But nonetheless, people want answers straight out. And I think to a great extent, we in media ruined the web. The web is filled with junk. It's filled with efforts to grab our attention and clickbait and spam. And so I wonder what's going to happen in the future. I'm urging newspapers to think about trying to make their information available to AI companies with conditions, with pay and with credit, so that we can try to improve AI and improve the new ecosystem of news and information. That's going to be hard to do because newspapers don't tend to cooperate with anybody.
You know, one of the sort of McLuhan-esque advantages of print is, and you alluded to it at the beginning of our conversation, the idea of a beginning and an end. And anybody who spends a lot of time ingesting information and news in the digisphere these days, you never know when you're beginning or when you're ending. One of the reasons I started to read this magazine called The Week, which is just a summation of all the news, and it's, you know, everything's very short and not detailed, but they look at all kinds of different disciplines and genres and international news. And when I'm all done reading The Week, I sort of feel like, okay, maybe I kind of have a handle. Maybe I don't have too many blind spots in my mirror right now. And I'm done. I can put down The Week. But we can put down the internet, but there's no particular signal, Jeff, that you can put down the internet.
Well, but I think, Colin, that the print gave us many myths to believe in. One is the myth of mass, that we're all one big lump of humanity, mm-hmm. losing our identity. Another one is the myth of the story and the storyteller as an oracle from on high. There's nothing that makes a journalist necessarily smarter than anybody else. But we just know how to find the people who are smart. And there's also this myth that things do have an alpha and an omega. The world isn't so neat. And we in news made it appear as if it were that neat. And that, to a great extent, was a myth and even a lie. Life is more complicated than we presented it.
Yeah, I mean, I just for the sake of conversation, to push back a little bit, particularly with that idea of the end of mass. And I know what you mean, and I think there was something potentially kind of toxic about the idea of mass. But there's also something potentially toxic about the idea of this hopelessly balkanized landscape of people who are, you know, getting all of their news from, you know, Joe Rogan or something like that, or the Epoch Times, or, you know, but somebody else is getting their information somewhere else. And you have ultimately, like you, I teach, and our class motto this year, it was, is the news a thing or is it just a lot of different versions of that thing by a lot of different people? And one of the risks of the human scale is having no access really to something that settles arguments about what is true.
So I helped start a program called engagement journalism, which deals more with listening to people and understanding. And I've come to believe lately that the problem we have in society is not about facts. It's not about disinformation. It's not even about belief. When people tell pollsters that they believe some crazy crap, I think they're trying to signal belonging to something. And I think if we read Hannah Arendt, we see the danger in people who don't feel they belong to anything. They become vulnerable to the siren call of a cult or an insurrection. And so I wonder what a journalism looks like that connects people in different ways, that makes strangers less strange, that tries to help us understand each other at a deeper level. I don't think that's just about facts.
You know, I do agree with you. I think it's a great point, actually. You know, one of the reasons that we're doing this show is that I started to read articles in the Columbia Journalism Review and places like that about maybe print is making a comeback. High school kids love their high school newspapers, that having an actual physical newspaper to read, all that kind of stuff. I'm assuming you don't buy it.
I think that books have survived the onslaught of ebooks and are healthy and at least fairly voluminous as they have been. But I do not buy it when it comes to newspapers and magazines. What I've been yelling at newspapers about for, oh God, now 2 decades, and I used to work in the industry for a long time, is that we have to see that day in the near future when print is no longer sustainable. And if we're not fully sustainable digitally by then, we'll die. Well, right now, I think that the health of you've worked with a company that I think is very good, Hearst. I worked with one that Advance was very good. But most big newspaper chains in this country are now owned and controlled by hedge funds, which cut to the marrow, do not invest, do not innovate. The health of newspapers is no longer the barometer of the health of the information ecosystem in America. And so I think that in some cases, the newspapers that are so bad, they do need to die and be replaced by something more vibrant and more of the community. And I just did a lot of research in California where I found that 18 of 25 newspapers, top newspapers there, are owned by hedge funds, but there's a huge vibrant structure of Black, Latino, LGBTQ community and digital media. That's the future.
You know, last question, Jeff Jarvis. I think a lot about McLuhan. So do you. I think about what he would think about what he would be saying right now. I think about just telling him, oh, well, Marshall, there's this thing called push notifications. And he'd say, well, what's that? And we'd say, well, you know, you'd have a thing. You have a thing and it's in your pocket. It's probably very close to your skin or it's in your pocketbook. And it might even throb or something or buzz to tell you that something has happened. And you take the thing out and you look at it and you find out right now what has happened. And if we told him all that and showed him how a push notification works, I'm assuming what he would say is, oh, well, then print really is dead because the human being has started to change. Its dendrites are now extended to this device they carry around with them. They're not even the same creature that used to sit and read a newspaper or a magazine. They actually participate in the information ecosphere in a totally different way. I'm not asking you a question. I'm just actually hoping you'll respond to what I'm saying.
Yeah, I would love to hear what McLuhan would say and also Neil Postman today. Yeah. I don't know that they would be fond of where we are today. And McLuhan points out that every medium uses as its content, at the first at least, the content of the last medium.
Yep.
And I think that's the phase we're in with the internet and AI, is that they are trying to replicate what existed in the past. And you know, one of the most fascinating things out of the Gutenberg parenthesis that I found was that print didn't really see a huge rush of innovation, the invention of the novel, the invention of the essay, the invention of the newspaper, until 150 mm-hmm. years after Gutenberg. It took that long to see the technology as boring and taken for granted. And people asked, what can we do with this now? So I think we're a far bit away from that now in the present day. We're mainly seeing newspapers, magazines, TV, radio being replicated on the internet. We haven't yet seen, I don't think, apart from maybe TikTok, something that's entirely new.
We're going to have to stop there, reluctantly. Jeff Jarvis, author of The Gutenberg Parenthesis, The Age of Print and Its Lessons for the Age of the Internet. His new book, The Web We Weave, will be out this fall. Listen, it's been great to talk to you.
It was great to talk to you, Colin. Thank you.
Okay. Bye-bye now. Time to say some words of thanks to our technical producer, Kat Pastor, and to the senior producer of the Colin McEnroe Show, Lily Tyson, who is the producer of this episode. So you might have just heard Jeff Jarvis referencing the idea that I work or have worked for, or will work for, Hearst. So did John Garrett, our next guest, founder and CEO of Community Impact, a privately owned chain of more than 40 community newspapers in Texas, reaching I think about 70 or more communities. I think it goes into the physical mailboxes of more than 2 million people. And the company also includes its own printing facilities, which we're going to talk about in just a second. But John, I think I'm correct. You used to work for the Houston Chronicle?
Right. Hearst as well.
So explain what it is that you're doing now. Explain how this whole thing works. This is called Community Impact. What does Community Impact do?
So about 18 years ago, we started Community Impact, Game Over the House type of story. But the idea was to kind of create a local business journal for the average resident. And I was working at the business journals, American City Business Journals at the time. It felt like there was something missing at the community journalism side, less sports and more city government development, that kind of thing. And this was 2005. I learned how expensive it was to, you know, acquire a subscriber. So I said, hey, let's do it for free. And there's a lot of print publications that are free, but to have, you know, kind of high quality journalism delivered for free in the mail was kind of what we decided to go after, which was obviously was very expensive, but it worked. And people really appreciated the quality of journalism, and we sold advertising right against those readers, and the advertisers kind of paid for the product.
Yeah, we should maybe make that distinction here too, which is that obviously there's advertising on in online journalism, the online versions of newspapers, but it's always kind of feels a little bit more hopeful than clearly effective. Obviously, you can measure the clicks and stuff like that. There's something about a physical ad in the newspaper that I think you're discovering resonates differently with the, both the users and the advertisers.
Yeah, I mean, the whole model of the print publication works way better than digital news. And you'd know that just by going to a digital news site where it's like you have to have autoplay videos and pop-ups. You know, you almost have to annoy the reader to be able to make enough money to pay for the journalism. And, you know, so it, just the way the digital business works, you really like the math on the print product if you can make it work, because basically all the advertisers kind of share for all the journalism. Whereas if one of the problems with digital journalism is, you know, to get a story that gets enough eyeballs where you can pay for it, you're writing about things that sometimes aren't as impactful of journalism that we all want. Sometimes you're writing a story that might only impact three people, but it's important. And if you're doing that on a digital platform, you're just not going to get the eyeballs for the advertisers to find that it's worth it. But if you're doing it for a print platform, then advertisers are all kind of paying for that really high quality journalism together, if that makes sense.
Yeah, no, it totally makes sense to me. And you know, having worked in the news business before there was any such thing as digital, you know, one of the real changes, and I think it is one of the original sins of digital journalism, is that they're able to measure what gets a lot of clicks. And if it turns out there's some lurid murder that gets a lot of clicks, there'll be three or four stories per day in some newspapers for weeks and weeks and weeks and months and months and months stretching into the trial, because they can measure what it wants. And they're not especially interested in the three people that you're talking about, right?
That's exactly right. It's the incentives are all misaligned, and it makes sense that social platforms like Facebook and TikTok, those guys, they can make money because it's all user generated content. They don't have to pay for the content, and they don't care. Like whatever video is the most popular, they don't care. They're just running the ads. Where in our business, you know, we care about the journalism and we care about making sure that what we're writing about is helping keep making that community great. And you know, sometimes those stories aren't, you know, the most popular and or that, you know, reach that many people. So it's just, you know, I think the model itself is very difficult. I think everyone in our industry understands how hard it is.
I mean, the other thing you have an opportunity to do is to make it look better. I worked for the Hartford Current for 20 years. By the beginning of this century, the Hartford Current was winning, you know, international awards for newspaper design. It's hard to do anything on the web that's comparable to what a good looking newspaper layout is. But say something about that.
Yeah, that's right. I mean, we have we have 180 employees, and 27 or 30 or so are designers. So we care a lot about the way the paper looks. We want people to be delighted. And your last host, who I have a lot of admiration for, Jeff, you know, that he's talking about the hedge funds that they just decimated the product. Anybody that actually operates, like, you know, the people who really operate the Houston Chronicle, they know how profitable that paper is. And the paper itself is still incredibly profitable for the New York Times. And so the question is can you delight the readers in print, you know, every time they get the print product? And I think a lot of our industry has gotten away from that, and we haven't. So our papers are fantastic, full color, a lot of infographics. I tell my staff, like, when the paper comes in the mail, because our readers aren't paying for it, we've got to delight them. Like, they got to look forward to it. And I think that that's something that's been missing in our industry as we pivot to digital. You know, there's a lot of technology spin that has to happen. There's resource issues. And we sometimes lose track that, hey, it's our print product that's really paying all the bills. What if we, like, invested in it and took more pride in that? I think that we might be surprised. Well, I mean, our numbers are really good and we're profitable. We're growing our print product I call it the Texas miracle. It's our print advertising is growing. And as you know, that's just not common in our space.
No, the other thing you have is a print facility there in the building, which is also very, very rare for newspapers. The Hartford Current was printed in its in the same building where I worked in the city room for many, many years. That's no longer the case. It also means one of the ways we found you was in the Columbia Journalism review article about print getting cool again. You're printing a lot of these high school newspapers, and kids seem very excited. High school students seem very excited about the print version of journalism. Tell us what you're experiencing there.
Yeah. So in December, I lost my print manager. And so I just decided, hey, things are going good on the news side. I'm going to go spend some time over at our printing company. And yeah, I was just surprised. I was talking to, you know, local high school teachers about how important it was to get this print product out, and talking with them and hearing that, yeah, the next generation, they don't want to just see their work on you know, a digital you know, device. They want to see it in print, and the students like it. And so I think, you know, we all know that there's challenges. It is more convenient, you know, to be on your phone sometimes. But I wouldn't write off print altogether. In fact, you know, I mean, Jeff's been saying print's been dead for 20 years, and most of his takes have been spot on. And but there's still something there. And again, if you talk to the people who run, you know, these well-run newspaper companies, they'll tell you how important that print product is from a profit and loss standpoint.
So do you get from your subscribers and the people who receive your newspapers in their mailboxes, do they want more? I would imagine if they're very happy with what you do, they might want you to do it more often than you're doing it.
Yeah, so we're monthly print, and the pandemic brought us the daily email, which has been very popular for news organizations around the country. And so we started during the pandemic, you know, writing a daily email about how many people got COVID, you know, in the cities we cover, and it just took off. And so, yeah, now we used to be a monthly print operation. We're now a daily a news organization. Every day we send out over 150,000 emails to subscribers in Texas. And so, yeah, we think, I like this idea of digital, where, you know, your physical product, your print product that gets out there to the community that says, hey, you're real, I can trust you. Mm-hmm. And then the digital product, obviously, is the convenience and the timeliness that happens, what happened last night at City Hall, for example. You know, I like the future combination. Maybe we just lucked out into, you know, being a frequency of once a month print, where you have legacies that have a hard time, you know, with a daily print product. There's a lot of issues with that. And so maybe the future does look digital, you know, and I like that. And I think we're seeing it from our readers and hearing it from our readers that they like that as well.
This is going to be really quick because I'm kind of out of time. But are other people approaching you and saying, maybe I'd like to start up a print company too? I mean, are there going to be imitators?
Yeah, for sure. I mean, there have been imitators in the past. I think the hard part about doing what we're doing is you have to be very committed to the journalism, and you have to be very committed to the design that we found on the print side, and you have to have a really good sales operation, and we have a really good sales operation. So I think all of it has to come together, but yeah, I welcome it. I think it's one of those things where if everyone is successful in journalism, we really all win. And I think that's something, if I can help anybody, I'd love to help explain what we do. And I have in the past.
Got to stop there. John Garrett, the founder and CEO of Community Impact. Thank you. Privately owned chain of more than 40 community newspapers in Texas. We will leave you now, but we will return to do more damage to the world. Oh, hopefully not tomorrow.